good morning and happy Sabbath. Everybody got that handout at the beginning? Yes, okay, all right. Follow that. At the end of this message, we will talk a little bit about that. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, I'm going to be reading there verses 14 through 18. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 14 through 18. You remember this passage when we had our stations this morning. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for the saints. Amen. I remember still that day when I came to my senses in the city of Babylon. I woke up that morning, and as usual, I had chains about my wrists, and I had my daily ration of moldy bread and stale water, and I was dressed in dirty rags. And every day I've been blaming others for my condition. Every day I was thinking of what my parents did or what my siblings did or what some friends did. But that day, I came to realize it was me. It was me. I was the one to blame for the situation that I was in. I was convicted on that day that it was my condition, the condition I was because of my choice. And I was in deep remorse that day, longing for freedom, longing for a new start, longing for a change. And I heard some commotion on the west side of the city, near where I was. And a soldier came to me, clad in armor and bearing an interesting-looking sword. And he looked at me and he said, "Do you want to be free?" And I was suspicious. I was suspicious about that question. But though I was doubting his sincerity, I looked closely at him, and this man had a true look of nobility. He had a look of sincerity, yet he also bore the marks of one who had gone through some serious struggles. And he looked at me and he said, "The king has sent me." And he asked again, "Do you want to be free?" And I said, "Yes." And he took that sword and he cut through my chains so very easily. I was overwhelmed with gratitude, and I asked him, "What can I do? What can I do for you helping me?" And he said, "Go to the top of the hill, go see the king at the top of the hill, and he will tell you what to do." And I was able, for the first time in so long, to stand up and go running, and I went running up that hill. It was a pretty lengthy trek, but as I was going up the hill, I was thinking to myself, who is this king he's talking about? And if he was sent by the king, what's this king going to require of me now that I'm free? What is the king going to tell me what to do? And I began going up that hill, and I began to harbor some reservations. I began to get a little concerned. Who can I trust, you know, after what I've been through? But as I came near the top of the hill, there I saw him. It was definitely the king. And I looked at him, and I was moved, and he spoke to me, and he said, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I sanctified you and ordained you to be my soldier." And I saw him, and he had eyes that looked through my soul, and yet one that I can trust, one that I knew had my well-being in mind. And I said, "Lord, I will be your servant. Tell me what you want me to do." He fed me that day. He washed me that day. He clothed me that day. He was doing things to me that day that a servant is supposed to do to a king. And yet here is a king doing it to a servant. And we spent several days on the top of that hill, and he taught me some precious things. Well, time came. A day came when he told me, "You must go back to the city of Babylon." And I did a big, what? He said, you must go back to the city of Babylon. And he began clothing me with some special garments. He said, put this around your waist. He said, this is the belt of truth. This is going to hold all your armor together. If it is loose, or if you take it off, everything falls apart. And he put something over my chest and around my shoulders. He said, this is the breastplate of righteousness. This is to guard your heart, for it will be attacked continually. And he gave me some sandals for my feet. And he said, always run to others and share with them the things that you have experienced. And he gave me a shield. And I said, my king, what is this for? He said, always hold this up, because this will quench the darts of those who are on top of the walls of the city of Babylon. And then he put something on my head and he said, this is the helmet of salvation. Always guard your thoughts and always remember my words to you. And then he gave me this unique sword. I saw that sword in the hands of the soldier that freed me. He gave me this sword and he said, this is the sword of the Spirit. Use this to deliver those that are in bondage. The truth will set them free. But he gave me also a solemn warning. I noticed the sword had two edges. And he told me, understand this, that if you do not use this sword properly, you're going to be cut. It will cut you. And he told me, go back to the city of Babylon. Seek and save those who are lost. And he said, I have appointed you to a leader. There's a leader that you're going to find on the east side of the city at one of those gates. And I have appointed you to that leader. And he said, lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. And I had great joy because I realized then that I was given the opportunity to do for others what had been done for me. So I began my descent down that hill. And as I went down that hill, I ran into a comrade, another soldier who was clothed as I was. And we began talking with one another. We began sharing with one another. I shared with him my story of what I did in Babylon and the price that I paid, but how this king had mercy on me. And he shared a similar story with me. And we bonded. It was wonderful. A bond formed between us that I had never had before, a friendship that I never knew existed. And we were eager to do the work of the king in the city of Babylon. Well, we went to the east side, and we found that leader that we were assigned to. And he called for some to help pick up a battering ram and go against one of the gates. And my comrade and I, we were eager to volunteer. And the leader warned us, always hold up your shield of faith to guard against those who are on the wall of Babylon, because they're going to be firing at you constantly. And so with one shoulder, we held the battering ram, and with the other arm, we held up the shield of faith. Well, we made that first attempt, and it failed. Some of us were going quick, some of us were going slow, and some of us weren't going at all. And so it didn't work too well. Now, I noticed after that first attempt, close to the gate, there was a shallow ditch. And in that ditch, there were people who were mocking us. And I looked over at them. And strangely, they were dressed exactly as we were. They had the same breastplate. They had the same belt. They had the same helmet. But I noticed, though they had the same shield, they were not holding it up. They had it down by their feet. And I was perplexed because the archers on top of the wall, they were throwing the arches, they were throwing the darts at us, but they were not throwing it at those in the shallow ditch. I was puzzled about that. Well, we made another attempt, and the second attempt failed. Again, some of us went fast, some of us went slow, some of us just didn't move at all. And the mockers again began ridiculing us and said, this can't be done. Why are you wasting your time? We tried to get through that gate and we couldn't. You are doing this in vain. I tried to ignore their remarks, but they spoke with such a great deal of confidence they spoke as people who had such experience and knew what they were talking about, I began wondering. We made another attempt, and it failed. And at this time, there was disunity among us. At this time, we were grumbling. At this time, we began complaining. And I had a personal frustration. I began questioning the leader who we were assigned to. And the mockers in the shallow ditch began ridiculing the leader as well. And to my shock and to my dismay, my comrade, who I met when we were descending down the hill, he threw his shield down and said, "Why are we doing this? This is a waste of time. Why are we following this leader? Does he really think we can get through that gate?" And immediately, once he threw down that shield, the archers on the top of the wall of Babylon took a shot at him and nailed him with one of the darts. We ran over to him and dragged him away, but he was paralyzed. He was unresponsive. We tried to wake him up. We tried to speak to him, but he was totally unresponsive. And the leader told us we must move on. We must make another effort. He's not going to respond to us, and there's nothing we can do for him. We must get back to the battering ram. My heart was torn from my chest. My heart was heavy. I had a sense of loss that I never felt before. But we went back to the work. We put the battering ram on top of our shoulder, and we were about to take another effort at it. But as we were about to do that, I noticed that my comrade, who had been hit by the darts, suddenly got up, and he walked over to the shallow ditch and joined with the mockers. And with them began ridiculing us. I noticed whenever I looked over there, his eyes wouldn't make contact with me, but he continued to mock our efforts. So we made a fourth attempt, and again that failed. And at this time, I was discouraged. At this time, I was considering joining ranks in that shallow ditch. I had lost basically all hope. At that point, the leader gathered us together and said to us, "Look up on the top of that hill again." And we looked up there, and we saw the king again. A look of compassion, a look of love, a look of grace. And the leader spoke to us and said, "Our king came here to Babylon himself, and he shed his blood for us. And he sent us here to seek and to save those that are lost. And his promise was to us, 'Lo, I am with you always.' And his promise was is that the gates of hell will not prevail against us. We need to look on him. We need to fix our eyes on him when we are holding this battering ram." All of us at that point took courage. All of us at that point were drawn to the king. All of us at that point gathered up faith and put our trust in his word and in his promise. All of us at that point realized that we were relying on ourselves and going by our own timing, depending on our own efforts. And we began forward at that point in his name in unity, all in the same pace. And we took one more lunge, and at that point, the gate of hell was like rice paper. And we broke through and got into the city. The leader told us, "Search through the city. Go to those who are in prison. Go to those who are in chains. But only work for those, only spend time for those who truly want to be free." I didn't fully understand what he meant at that point, but I came to the first prisoner that I saw. And I came to that prisoner, like me at one time. He was dressed in rags. He had chains about his wrist. He had moldy bread to eat. He had stale water, and he had a sour puss. And I came to him, and I said, "I've come to set you free." And he said, "What are you talking about?" And I said, "Do you want to be free?" And he said, "I am free. What do you think, I'm a slave or something?" And I pointed to the chains around his wrist, but he would not look down. And I said, "Look at the straps that you're eating off of," but he would not look down. He said, "I'm free." And I was confused, but I knew I had to move on. I went to the next prisoner that I saw, and the same condition as what the first prisoner was in, but she had a smile on her face that seemed to be forced, a smile that seemed to be disingenuous. And I came to her, and I said, "Do you want to be free?" And she looked up at me and said, "Why would I want that? Why would I want something like that?" And I told her, "The king will make you free. He will give you a life. He will give you a new start. You will have no regrets. I trust me, I've gone through this. Life will be so much more meaningful. Life will be so much better for you." But she said, that might be fine for you, but I'm okay with what I'm have. I'm a happy person," she said. And I asked, "How can you be happy with scraps?" But I knew it was time to move on. I continued my search throughout the city of Babylon, and I heard one of the prisoners call to me. And he said, "I want to be free, I want to be free." And so I ran over to him. I said, "Yes, yes." I said, "The king has sent me to make you free." And so he held his hands up, ready for me to use the sword of the Spirit. And as I was about to cut through the chains, he withdrew. And he said, "What will life be like?" And so I began to share with him the things that I've enjoyed, the joy that I've had in doing these things. So he held his hands out again, and I was about to cut through, and he withdrew them. And he said, "What's the king going to require of me if I'm free?" And I said, "The king puts no burden on you. You will have a life of joy. Oh, you will want to serve the king once you're free." And so he put his hands out again, and I'm about to cut the chains, and he withdrew them again. "What's going to happen to my friends in Babylon?" And oh, this went on for a little while. About to cut the chains and another question. About to cut the chains and another question. The leader saw me. The leader saw what was going on. And he told me, "Seek for those who truly want to be free." And I understood what he meant at this point. And so I moved on and began looking for others. But again, that prisoner continued calling to me. He said, "I want to be free. I want to be free. I want to be free." But I could not listen. I came across another prisoner, a prisoner that was hunched over, a prisoner that appeared to be filled with deep remorse, a prisoner that had that moldy bread, that stale water, dressed in rags. And I came to him and said, "Do you want to be free?" And he said, "Don't stir up my hearts with false hopes. Don't give me ideas of things that are never going to happen." And I told him, "The king has sent me here to make you free." And I shared with him my story of where I was at that point and what I have had since my chains were cut off. I shared with him the things that the king has taught me and what the king did for me when I met him at the top of the hill. And so I said, "Do you want to be free?" And he said, "Yes, I want to be free, and I want to see this king." And I cut through those chains with the sword of the Spirit. And I said, "Go to the king at the top of the hill, and he will tell you what to do." And this went on. All of us who broke through that gate of hell, walking, running throughout the city, looking for those who truly wanted to be free. And we continued searching for throughout the city. And then suddenly we heard a voice from the top of the hill that said, "He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man and woman according to their work." Our leader said, "Our work is done here now. We will not find anybody else who truly wants to be free." So we began gathering together, and then we heard a voice again from the top of the hill, "Come out of her, my people, that you be not partaker of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues." So we all ran from that city. We all got out of that city as fast as we could, and we gathered together at the east. Joy filled our hearts as we began finding those who set us free or those that we were able to set free. A wonderful reunion was taking place. But those in the shallow ditch, they continued to mock. They continued to ridicule. And they talked about how few, from their perspective, how few we were able to get out of that city. "Why weren't you able to get any more?" Why weren't you able to get this person? Why weren't you able to get that person? And then we heard one more time from the top of the hill, three precious words, "It is done." And the clouds above us grew dark. Great thunder and a mighty shaking began to take place. And the walls of the city began to heave. And the walls of the city began to crack. And I notice that the demeanor of those in the shallow ditch suddenly changed at that point. And they had a look of terror. They had a look of horror. And the archers on the wall were horrified and began looking for a place to hide at that point. And the king began his descent from the top of the hill with a consuming fire all around us. And those within the city began crying out and saying, "The great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand?" But we who were dressed in that armor, we who labored to bring others out of that city, we were at peace. We knew the answer to that question, trusting our souls to the great king. My brothers and sisters, where will you be on that day? Which of these characters will you be found associated with? Where will you be found on that day? Will you be found in the city of Babylon as one of the archers on the wall? Will you be found as one of the prisoners who are blind to their own status? Will you be found as one of the prisoners that are satisfied with scraps? Will you be found as one of the prisoners that fear the freedom that the king alone can give you? Will you be found as one of those in the shallow ditch that ridicule the work of salvation? Will you be found as one of those comrades that forfeits their faith in the face of reproach and ridicule and frustration? Or will you be found a soldier that holds fast his faith in the king regardless of the circumstances? The decisions that we make today determine where we are going to be. Father in heaven, Lord God Almighty, we pray that you would grant unto us the faith, that you grant unto us the strength, that you grant unto us the perseverance that we need to be found as one of those soldiers who will keep the shoulder under the battering ram regardless of what takes place, that will be one of those soldiers that seeks for those who want to be saved, that will be one of those soldiers who work for you, leading those who are in chains to the freedom of Christ. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's take a moment here before we have our